Recorded Books presents Dreamer's Throne by Seth Ring, narrated by Michael Kramer. Chapter 1. It wasn't the scratchy sheets that finally convinced him he wasn't dreaming, nor was it the watery gruel that seemed to get thinner with every meal, or even the dull ache of his missing arm. Rather, it was the strange movie-like dreams he had of a young man named Garrett Klein, whose life scrolled out before him, unreeling in a jerky blur. With every dream, memories of his life on Earth twisted, merging with the moments of the body he had come to inhabit. After 4 days of drifting in and out of hazy wakefulness as his weak body tried to overcome the life-threatening blood loss he'd suffered, he finally woke up for real, a clear certainty in his mind. He wasn't on Earth anymore. Hearing harsh shouting outside his door, he tried to swallow, nearly choking as his sandpaper tongue stuck to the roof of his mouth. There was a rough mug of water on the floor by the pile of ragged clothing serving as his bed, but as he reached for it, he remembered that he lacked a hand. It had been shocking to wake up missing his right hand, but right now getting a mouthful of water was the only thing occupying his mind. The shouting seemed to be getting louder, and as he rolled over and reached for the cup with his left hand, the door burst open, shaking the room. A burly man stomped into the room, his jaw set and his lips pressed in a grim line. Behind him, a young woman followed, trying to grab his arm and suffering a backhanded slap for her efforts that sent her tumbling to the wall with a thud. Despite the flash of pain that crossed her face, she jumped right back to her feet and rushed toward the burly man again, only to stop in shock when she saw that Garrett was awake, shakily carrying the mug of water to his lips. Hurrying past the burly man, who had stopped in the middle of the floor, she helped Garrett lift the mug up, supporting his back as he tried to prop himself up. His waist seemed unnaturally weak, but he managed to get himself high enough to get a mouthful of water. He wanted nothing more than to pour the entire mug down his throat, but he knew from experience that, in his current state, it would do more damage than help. Feeling the cool water trickle down his throat, he took another mouthful, holding it in his mouth and letting his parched tongue absorb as much of it as possible. Swallowing was hard, so rather than take another drink, he lay back down, his strength all but exhausted. Seeing he was done, the young woman put the mug down on the rough floorboards and turned to face the burly man.
"See? He isn't dead."
"Doesn't matter if he's dead or not. I told you, your time is up. You've stayed as long as your coin will last. So it's time for you to get out. Either you leave by lunchtime or I'll drag both of you out myself."
Without giving the young woman any chance to respond, the burly man turned and stomped out of the room, slamming the door. Like a deflating balloon, the young woman sagged, her shoulders trembling as she slumped on the floor. Behind her, Garrett couldn't help but raise one eyebrow, a habit brought from his previous life.
"Excuse me," he said, his voice like rough paper brushing together. "I don't think I know you."
No matter how he racked the new memories that swirled through his mind, he couldn't recall ever having seen this young woman before a few days ago, when he woke up in this sorry excuse for an inn. This shouting match had repeated every day for the last few days, ending with the young lady handing over a small copper coin. But today was clearly different. When she heard his voice, the young woman jerked in surprise, spinning around to stare at Garrett, her eyes carefully tracing his pale face. Her direct stare allowed him an equally good look at her, noting the large burn scar that ran across her nose, cheek, and half her upper lip. Her matted brown hair, cut raggedly in a bob, didn't look particularly good on her, but he supposed its utility made up for its mushroomness. Surprise and excitement, mixed with a natural wariness, colored her eyes, which were so dark they looked black. But the excitement faded as she took in Garrett's weak body.
"Tell Rin. You can call me Rin."
"Nice to meet you, Rin. My name is..."
Trailing off, Garrett blinked. What was his name? Two sets of memories swirled around his head, merging and diverging in a dizzying mix. On Earth, his name had been Paul Geller, but as of 4 days ago he had woken up in the body of the young nobleman Garrett Klein. He had no idea why, but his memories from this world and the memories of the middle-aged man from Earth had intertwined, becoming inseparable. Was he Paul, or was he Garrett? With a wince, he tried to clear his head. As always, survival was the most important thing, even if it meant reconstructing his identity. Only hesitating for a moment, he pretended to cough to cover for himself.
"Excuse me. My name is Garrett. Thank you for saving me." "It seems it will be for nothing," Rin said bitterly, shaking her head. "We're about to get thrown out. You won't last more than a day on the street in your condition. If the scroungers don't get you, the rats will."
"Which is why we need to change that,"
Garrett said, his voice barely a whisper as his eyes drifted to the floor.
"Am I correct in thinking that you've used the last of your money and can no longer afford the rent for this room?"
Staring at Garrett, Rin took a moment to answer. On top of having a strange way of talking, there was a calmness to his words that gave her pause. Most people, having woken from a terrible fever, would barely be coherent, but he was operating with a cold efficiency that took her by surprise.
"No more money," she finally said, shrugging. "That greedy skinflint is charging us twice the normal rate."
"I see. One of the curses of being powerless, but one we cannot change at the moment."
Closing his eyes, Garrett appeared to be thinking, so Rin just waited, curious of what he would say. She was feeling better about this whole thing, not because she wouldn't be able to survive once she was thrown into the street, but because she had rescued Garrett, thinking he would be her ticket out of the slums. Though his clothing had already been stripped when she found him by the river, his face and his delicate fingers marked him as someone of noble birth, and she'd been hoping that, once he woke up, he'd feel so happy he would give her a reward. However, as the days passed and he continued to writhe in a feverish sweat, she'd realized just how foolish her idea had been. Even if he did wake up, what good was a young nobleman who'd been dumped into the river after his arm had been chopped off? It was more likely she was inviting trouble by saving him, but something in her heart wouldn't let her abandon him, and with great reluctance she had spent the last few coins she'd managed to save to keep him alive.
"The first step is to extend our stay," Garrett murmured, fighting against the exhaustion threatening to drag his eyelids shut. "You should have a secret stash. Use it to buy us one more day."
"What? No, no way!"
Rin protested, shaking her head, only to realize that Garrett was already asleep. Grumbling, she got to her feet, fully intending to march right out of the room, out of the inn, and out of Garrett's life, leaving him to his fate. Yet there was something about him that made her footsteps falter. Slowing down as she reached the door, she heard a whisper behind her and turned around, returning to listen to what he was mumbling in his feverish state.
"One more day."
Rin bit her lip, torn. He was right, she did have a secret stash, one she had sworn never to touch except in a dire emergency. The worst thing was, it was a silver coin, enough for a commoner to live in the slums for a full month. But if she took it out, Henrik would snatch it whole, leaving her with nothing. In vain, she tried to convince herself to leave, but she couldn't shake the feeling that she would be missing out on something important if she did. Completely oblivious to the mental struggle Rin was undergoing, Garrett's mind had sunk into a haze-filled space that had slowly been taking shape over the past 4 fever-filled days. It looked like the room he had been spending his days in, but instead of lying in a pile of clothing on the floor, Garrett was observing the room from above, almost as if he was a disembodied spirit. He could see a figure in the room, sitting in an ornate chair glowing with faint light, allowing Garrett to see every inch of its intricate carvings. It reminded Garrett of the pictures he'd seen of ancient thrones in his last life. The figure in the chair, however, was entirely fuzzy, as if they were shrouded in an impenetrable fog.
"Hidden throne system initializing. Please wait while the dream module is loading. Module loaded. Welcome to the world of Jorah. You are the single remaining player, determining potential paths. Paths selected. Please enter your avatar and proceed with your path selection. Hearing the mechanical voice echoing through his mind, Garrett couldn't help but look around, searching for the source of the strange words. Finding nothing in the room besides the glowing chair and the shadowy figure, he tried to communicate with the voice, but found himself unable to speak. After a dozen tries, he gave up and focused on the figure. There were too many mysteries, too many unknowns, but his pressing need to find a way to stay in the inn moved him to act. The voice said I should go into my avatar. Is that the figure on the chair? As soon as he thought about it, Garrett found his consciousness rushing forward, drilling down into the back of the hazy figure's head. Immediately his vision changed, and he saw a window pop up in front of him. Available paths. Path of the Blade. Path of the Ghost. Path of the Watcher. Realizing he could select each of the paths to learn more about them, Garrett opened the first option to examine it in more detail. Path of the Blade. Growing in strength through slaying those nightmares that stalk the dream world, the blade learns to shape ether into an unsurpassed weapon, using it to cut down their enemies. Powerful from the first, this path is suited to those with a fearless temperament who prefer facing things head-on. Survivability, high. Growth potential, low. The Path of the Blade appeared to be the standard warrior path, one focused on fighting against enemies directly. This feeling was confirmed as Garrett felt information appearing in his mind detailing the two abilities the Path of the Blade would grant him. The first was the creation of a weapon, while the second was the ability to accelerate rapidly. To Garrett, it felt like he was in the middle of one of those video games he'd heard about during his life on Earth. Though he'd never played one himself, there had simply been no time. He was at least familiar with how they worked, and the windows he was looking at seemed to mimic them. As nice as it would be to be able to create a sword, Garrett had no familiarity with using a sword as a weapon, and didn't like the idea of having to fight against nightmares, whatever they were, especially at close range. Apart from the high survivability, the Path of the Blade held little appeal for him. So he closed the window and opened up the next option, the Path of the Ghost. Path of the Ghost. Growing in strength through taming those nightmares that stalk the dream world, the ghost learns to use ether to control the denizens of the dream, commanding them to devour their foes. Largely helpless without their pets, this path is suited to those who prefer overwhelming their enemies through numbers. Survivability, moderate. Growth potential, moderate. Much like the Path of the Blade, the focus on fighting the Path of the Ghost took unsettled Garrett. He'd seen his fair share of fights during his past life, and had even participated in a number of them himself, but he much preferred settling things with other methods. As far as he was concerned, fighting was something you only did when you had no chance of losing. Just like the Path of the Blade, as soon as he opened the window, information regarding the skills associated with the Path of the Ghost appeared in his mind. The first was an ability that would allow him to capture nightmares, creatures native to the dream. He still had no idea what the dream was, but he assumed it was this hazy world he found himself in. According to the mechanical voice, it had loaded a dream module, whatever that was, which allowed him to enter this room. The second ability would allow him to command the nightmares he controlled, with greater degrees of success depending on how strong his control was. Not thrilled with the idea of having to rely on others, even if he was controlling them, Garrett closed the window and opened up the final path. Path of the Watcher. Growing in strength through observing the thoughts and actions of those who wander the dream, the Watcher learns to use ether to connect with those whose minds are touched by the dream. Though without a way to defend themselves initially, this path is suited for those who know how to make hidden knowledge work for them. Survivability, low. Growth potential, high. Like a light had gone off in his mind, Garrett stared at the window, reading it over three times to make sure he wasn't missing anything. Just the growth potential of the path was enough to make him ignore everything else and select it, but he wasn't one to rush into anything, so he did his best to think through the choice. Apart from the growth potential, he had a particular fascination with secrets, and a path built around them immediately sparked his interest.
though it would give him no direct advantages when it came to surviving, and even boasted a low survivability, Garrett had been surviving his whole life, and wasn't about to stop now, regardless of his path. Chapter 2. Just like the other two paths, the path of the Watcher granted two skills, and as he focused on the information, the details of each skill flooded his mind. Whisper of the Dream was a simple skill that allowed its user to project thoughts into the minds of others, while Observe the Dream allowed its user the ability to see the surrounding area clearly. Both skills appeared to be weak compared to the skills granted by the other two paths, or at least less impactful, but that suited Garrett just fine. He had already died once, at least if his memories from Earth were to be believed, and the experience, though a surprise, hadn't managed to shake his detached personality one bit. So it was with some casualness that he mentally selected the path of the Watcher and watched as the world warped around him. Blinking through his new eyes, he looked down at his hands that rested on the ornate chair's armrests. "This is my body from Earth. How is it here? And why did it only appear after I selected my path?" With nearly no information, there was no way for Garrett to figure out what was going on, so he gave up and began to examine his surroundings. The room had lost much of its haze, and the details continued to grow clearer as he stood up from his chair. To Garrett, it felt as if he stood in the real world, but there was a faint fluctuation at the corner of his vision that helped him understand that the room he stood in was part of the dream. Checking over his body, he was happy to see he was in perfect shape. His death on Earth had completely destroyed his body, but here he stood, as if the horrific damage his limbs had suffered had never happened. Suddenly struck with curiosity, he squatted down and did a few push-ups. Though he could feel his body going through the motions, no feeling of muscle fatigue accompanied the effort. Rather, he found himself growing sleepy as he expended his mental energy. Stopping, he stood again, his brow furrowing slightly. Garrett, or rather Paul, had always been hypersensitive to the changes of his mind, and his small test seemed to confirm what he had suspected. This world he'd entered wasn't a world of physical ability like the world where his body currently fought off the remnants of the fever that had plagued him for the last 4 days. Instead, it was a world of the mind, where his strength was measured by how clear his mind was. Shaking his head to clear away the many questions swarming him, Garrett walked over to the single doorway, trying the doorknob. Feeling it turn easily, he suddenly paused as a bunch of floating text appeared in his vision. "You are about to exit the safe zone and enter the dream. Once you leave, your choice of path will be locked, and the other paths will no longer be available. Selected path, Watcher. Stay, leave." It only took him a moment to review his choice, and with a small smile, he decisively opened the door leading out of the room. The hallway outside the door was long and dark, with only a hazy light that filtered through the window at the other end of the hall. There were two rooms off the hall, and a set of stairs that led up and down. But Garrett was much more interested in walking down to the end of the hall to peer out the window. To his disappointment, the only thing he saw was thick fog that shone with a phosphorescent glow. Unable to make out a single detail outside the window, he retraced his steps and stopped by the first of the doors, trying the doorknob. Just like the door to the room he'd started in, this one was unlocked as well, and he was able to open it up, revealing a haze-filled room that looked like an office. About to walk into the office, he suddenly realized there were other people in the room, causing him to freeze in the doorway.
Excuse me, Garrett said, his eyes darting between the three people in the room.
When none of them responded, he frowned and took a step into the room. Getting a better look at them, Garrett realized the three men weren't moving, but appeared to be held in place by the haze covering the room. Their bodies were slightly translucent, given both color and form by a light that shone from their heads. The strongest of the lights was in the head of the man who was sitting behind the desk,
and as Garrett got closer he found that he recognized him as the burly man who'd threatened to throw them out of the inn. Standing across the desk from him were two other muscular men whose lights were slightly weaker, whom Garrett had never seen before. As curious as he was about the lights radiating out of the three men, Garrett restrained his desire to reach out and touch them, and instead focused on the rest of the room. It only took him a moment to realize he could focus on an object, allowing it to jump into sharp relief as the haze that covered the room peeled back, but doing so caused his mental strength to drain at a noticeable rate. Blinking his eyes to shake the sudden mental fatigue he had accumulated, Garrett thought for a moment and then began to focus his attention on the desk, searching for something useful. There was a single open book and what appeared to be a letter on the desk, and as he scanned over them, he realized he was looking at a financial ledger. At first, the letters and numbers were strange to him, but after a moment, the education he had received as Garrett kicked in, and he was able to make sense of what he was looking at. Numbers had always been of interest to him back on Earth, so he continued to look down the page, noting that the book was using a simple credit and debit system with a running total at the bottom of the page. A faint scratching sound suddenly intruded on his hearing, and his head snapped up as a faint worry crept into his mind. Unsure where the worry was coming from, he looked around, his eye catching the window. Just like the window at the end of the hallway, this one was completely blocked by the glowing fog. But as Garrett looked up, he seemed to feel a creeping claw scratching lightly across it. Like a nail being dragged across glass, the sound caused his spine to vibrate, and with growing horror, he saw a pale hand with 6-inch nails appear on the window. Garrett had seen more than his fair share of corpses on Earth and instantly identified the hand as that of a dead body, but even as he watched, the fingers of the hand flexed, causing its long, sharp nails to rap against the window, shaking the glass. The feeling of horror that had been growing in Garrett's mind suddenly spiked, and he threw himself behind the desk, pulling his arms and legs in as he tried to get out of sight. His heart pounded as the icy terror gripping him continued to grow stronger, threatening to freeze the air in his lungs as it constricted his chest. Unable to see the window from where he was, Garrett thought he heard a cackling whisper, but was unable to pin it down. As terrified as he was, he also wanted to peer around the corner of the desk to take a look at what was outside the window. The urge to see began to grow in strength, and suddenly his vision shook, and Garrett found himself watching the room from above. He could see himself hiding behind the desk, his body curled up as small as he could make it.
"This must be Observe the Dream."
The three men remained where they had been, and the rest of the room was the same as well, proving that he was looking at a top-down view of the room. Touching his head, he saw his figure do the same, and as he blinked, his vision returned to normal. It took a couple tries for Garrett to figure out how to activate his ability, and once he did, he realized he could also control the remote view, moving his vision around as if it were a floating camera. As he played with the camera, the fear that gripped him began to fade, and Garrett activated Observe the Dream, turning it toward the window, trying to see if the figure was still there. When he found nothing but the fog, he let out a small sigh of relief and moved his vision closer, trying to see if he could peer out the window. As his view drifted closer to the glass, he suddenly saw the fog parting as if something was forcing its way through to the glass. The horror that had first seized him returned in a wave that smashed into his mind, causing his vision to go dark. But right before he faded out, he saw a cloaked figure with a single crimson eye that sat vertically in its face, running from its chin all the way up to its forehead. Unblinking, the eye stared into the room, sweeping this way and that as it tried to find him. With a jerk, Garrett woke up, his heart pounding and his face slick with sweat. A dull pain in his mind and a simple blue window floating in front of his face were all that remained of his encounter with the strange eye.
"You have discovered a new location, Dreamer's Throne. You have gained 1 EXP. You have observed a dreamer for the first time. You have gained 1 EXP. You have observed a seeking wraith, one of the low-ranked nightmares of the dream. You have gained 1 EXP. EXP 3 of 10. Waving the window away, Garrett groped for the mug of water in the darkness.
The room he was in had a small window set high up in the wall, and from the lack of light he could only assume it was early in the morning hours. Finding the mug, he lifted it to his lips, drinking down the water it contained. The sound woke up Rin, who was curled up near him, and in the sliver of light that entered the room from the crack under the door he could see her looking toward him. Faint sounds of shouting and laughter drifted from beyond the door, but Garrett couldn't make out what was being said.
"You bought us time."
His statement was loud in the dark room, even though he whispered, and Rin responded with an angry curse.
"I did! That greedy rat Henrik took my whole silver! 2 days! That's how long he gave us!"
"A silver. Worth 50 copper. 50 to a gold. Simple enough."
Cocking her head to the side as she heard Garrett's nonsensical muttering, Rin's eyes narrowed. She could barely see Garrett's thin body in the light from the hall, but somehow, as she stared at him, she suddenly got the feeling she was looking at a complete stranger she'd never seen before. Before she could pin the feeling down, it vanished, like a fleeting dream forgotten upon waking.
"2 days is better than I hoped. Thank you. I need more water, and my body is exhausted. I'll sleep now."
Almost instantly, Garrett was asleep again, leaving Rin staring at him in fuming anger. Her patience had just about worn thin, but she had already invested so much in him that she couldn't bear to walk away. And after a fierce internal struggle, she finally grabbed the mug and slipped out of the room to get more water. This time Garrett's sleep was dreamless, and he woke to the morning light slipping through the high window. Pushing the rags that covered him aside, he tried to sit up, only to find he couldn't leverage himself upright. After some consideration, he realized his legs didn't respond to anything he did, leaving him with the sinking realization that he wasn't going to be able to get himself around. Lying still, he closed his eyes and took stock of his situation. On top of his right arm, that appeared to have been cut off from the middle of his forearm, he had no strength from below his waist. It only took a moment for him to recall just how he'd arrived at this position, but doing so sent him on a rabbit trail of memories that curled through his mind. The body he'd merged with had grown up in the Palace of Insomnium, the city he was in, serving as the study aide to the then prince. Less than a week ago, the prince's family had been slaughtered by his uncle in a bid to seize control, and Garrett had been grievously wounded and thrown into the river as he tried to help the prince's younger sister escape. After drifting to shore, his body had been stripped of anything valuable, and he'd been left for dead, only to be picked up by Rin and brought to the inn where he was currently staying. He had no idea how or why his memories from Earth had mixed with the memories of the 17-year-old young man, but it no longer mattered. Garrett could feel that his two personalities had melded inseparably. The ice-cold, analytical, survive-at-all-costs attitude he had brought from Earth, and the passionate, idealistic, and social persona developed from his life on this world, had combined together to form the strange mix of rational analysis and creativity that now carried his thoughts forward. With a sigh, he turned his attention to the matter at hand, figuring out how to secure himself and avoid getting thrown out on his ear. A dozen ideas were considered and rejected, leaving only 3 possible options. Jora, the world Garrett found himself in, was much like a fantasy world from one of the stories on Earth. The level of technology was low, reminding Garrett of a feudal society from the Middle Ages. Unlike Earth, however, this world was inhabited by fierce monsters that could rip a human apart with no effort. Memories of dangerous beasts lurking outside of the walled city and rumors of prowling undead in the sewer system filled Garrett's thoughts, and for a few minutes he was lost in recalling just how dangerous a world he had landed in. Yet monsters weren't the only danger. Equally dangerous were those who carried a soul spark. Called awakened, they possessed souls that took on specific shapes, granting them supernatural powers, allowing them to go toe-to-toe with the vicious monsters that crept through the shadows. Though rare, it was these awakened who both protected and ruled the human strongholds that remained in this world, their words enforced by their powerful fists. Hearing the creak of a floorboard, Garrett looked up as the door opened, seeing Rin clutching half a loaf of coarse brown bread. Before she could unleash the mouthful of angry words she was holding, he did his best to push himself up and spoke calmly.
"We need to speak to Henrik. Please set up a meeting."
Chapter 3.
"If you're wasting my time, I'll throw you out right now," Henrik said, face warped in an angry grimace.
He was standing in the doorway of the small room, glaring down at Garrett. Rin had helped Garrett sit up before she went to get Henrik, and he was leaning with his back against the wall. Without being able to use his legs to brace himself, he had to use his left arm, leaving his right arm crossed across his lap. With a calmness that didn't suit his age, he matched gazes with the large innkeeper and spoke calmly.
"I'd like you to employ me. Pay Rin and I in room and board, and I'll help you in return."
"Help me?" Henrik laughed derisively. "You can't even help yourself. How will you help me?"
"I know how to read, write, and handle numbers," Garrett said, his voice even. "I can help you with your books. I've been trained as a scribe and money counter."
The change that came over Henrik's wide face when Garrett finished speaking was stark, though even his smile couldn't mask the threat of suspicion in his eyes. While reading and writing weren't entirely uncommon, the ability to handle numbers was rarer. Almost everyone in the city learned enough basic math to handle the small amounts of money they dealt with on a daily basis, but anything more complicated than simple addition and subtraction typically required the services of a money counter, a specialized scribe trained in advanced math. On Earth, a money counter would have been described as an accountant, though from Garrett's memories of this world, few money counters would have ever made it as more than a basic clerk. This was Garrett's first plan, and the one he hoped to use to grant himself the respite needed to get his bearings in the city. Money counters, like any other scribe, were difficult to come by in the slums, and also cost a veritable fortune to hire. Henrik was clearly interested in the idea, though his skepticism grew as his eyes traced Garrett's missing hand.
"What can you do with a missing hand?" the innkeeper asked, pointing at Garrett's stump.
"My left hand works fine," Garrett replied. "So long as you give me a chair and a pen, I can show you."
Still suspicious, Henrik looked back and forth between Garrett and Rin for a moment before he nodded.
"Fine. Come with me."
Turning, he was about to leave when he caught sight of a mocking smile on Garrett's lips. Anger surged across Henrik's face, causing his cheeks to flush red, but before he could explode, he saw Garrett patting his unresponsive legs.
"You'll excuse me, sir, but my mobility leaves much to be desired. I'm afraid I can't go anywhere with anyone."
Disarmed by the clear self-derision in Garrett's voice, Henrik let out a short laugh and waved his hand toward the two large thugs who stood in the hall.
"Obey and Gorm can help you. Get him to my office."
"Yes, boss,"
the two thugs echoed in unison as they squeezed into the small room. Grabbing Garrett's arms, they lifted him roughly, having no trouble holding him up as they dragged him out of the room, paying little attention as his legs scraped the ground. Undignified as it was, Garrett was too focused on other things to bother saying something. He'd occasionally gotten glimpses of the hall when the door opened, but as the two thugs carried him out, he felt his mind still, as if struck by lightning. The hallway was long, and light filtered in from the windows set at the other end. There was the same set of stairs leading up and down, and the same two doors in the middle of the hall, forming an exact replica of what Garrett had seen in the dream, apart from an extra door that blocked off the stairs going down, presumably toward the basement. Furthermore, it only took him a moment to realize the two muscular men dragging him toward the first door were the two figures he'd seen in Henrik's office. His mind whirling as he considered the implications of what he was seeing, Garrett only snapped back to the present when he was roughly shoved into a chair. Letting go of his arms, Obey and Gorn stepped back, smirking at him as he nearly fell from the chair. It was only Rin, who'd followed the men into the office, who managed to catch his shirt, preventing him from tumbling face first to the floor. Giving her a grateful smile, Garrett looked down at the desk and a shiver ran through him. Sitting on the desk was the same open account book and stack of letters he'd examined only a little while before. Unbidden, his eyes darted toward the window, almost expecting to see the thick fog that had obscured his view in the dream. Instead, he saw a dirty alleyway that led down to what looked like a small bay. He could see the masts of ships poking up here and there, along with some buildings in the distance. The sunlight, though weak since it was still morning, caused the shadow of the building he was in to stretch across the street, meaning the inn he was sitting in was much larger than the surrounding wooden and brick buildings.
"These are the accounts, but before you touch them, I want you to think long and hard about whether you really want to make the attempt. If you're lying to me about being a money counter, you'll find yourself taking a short swim in the river with your hands tied behind your back. Your friend here, too."
Henrik's words brought Garrett back to the present, and as he turned to look at the open book the innkeeper was pointing to, he saw Rin's clenched lips. Instead of responding, Garrett took a look at the book, confirming that the numbers he saw there were exactly the same as the numbers in the dream. He had no experience with the supernatural from his time on Earth, but the memories he'd merged with gave him no choice but to admit that this was a world of magic and mystery. If he hadn't merged with the memories of the young nobleman, he could only have assumed he was going crazy. But instead, a feeling of delight welled up inside his heart. Garrett had no idea how he'd ended up with the ability to walk in the dream, but he wasn't about to complain. Shaking the stray thoughts from his mind, he focused on the account book, running his index finger down the column of numbers, doing the math in his head. Henrik, Rin, and the two thugs, Obey and Gorn, all watched him, their gazes holding a variety of feelings, but Garrett paid them no mind. A small frown creased his forehead as he got to the bottom of the column. Before Henrik could ask him what was wrong, he started tracing his way back up the column until he got to a specific number. Tapping it, he looked up at the innkeeper.
"This is wrong. You're missing 30 silver."
Garrett had spotted this mistake the first time he'd examined the account book in the dream, and after confirming it in the real world, he was now convinced that the two were linked. Though he wasn't sure what was going on with the fog or the monster with the giant red eye he'd seen, he knew what he saw in the dream was the same as reality.
"What are you saying?"
Henrik asked, his eyes narrowing dangerously.
"Whoever did this calculation missed 30 silver. Your total at the bottom should be 30 silver higher."
The grim expression in Henrik's eyes was mirrored by a nervous expression in Gorn's eyes. But before the thug could say anything, Henrik stepped up next to Garrett.
"Show me."
Nodding, Garrett looked around for a pen, eventually spotting a quill. Thankful that his memories included extensive training with the old-fashioned pen, Garrett picked it up and awkwardly began to copy out the numbers onto a piece of paper Henrik pushed toward him. The only sound in the room was the soft scratch of the quill on the paper as everyone waited for him to finish.
"It's a fairly easy mistake to make if you don't carry the remaining 3, Garrett said, pointing to the numbers once he was finished. "I would double-check to make sure you still have the correct amount of money, but I'd guess this is just a calculation error, rather than embezzlement."
"Embezzlement?"
Henrik asked, his voice low and dangerous.
"Theft of funds,"
Garrett responded, his eyes drifting over toward Gorn. The large man was clearly nervous, but to Garrett, it didn't look like he was feeling guilty about something so much as he carried the stunned expression of a kid who'd dropped and broken a glass. Henrik, on the other hand, looked like he was going to burst a blood vessel. Shooting a glare at Gorn, he stormed out without another word, both of the thugs running after him. Watching the door slam, Garrett was left alone with Rin. With a sigh, he began flipping through the account book to pass the time while he waited for the innkeeper's return. A few times Rin opened her mouth as if she wanted to say something, but ultimately she stayed quiet and watched Garrett as he looked over the accounts. Shooting a glance at her, Garrett decided it was time to try and fill in some information he was missing.
"I don't remember if I've thanked you for providing for our stay up until this point. My hope is that Henrik will find me useful enough that we can stay without having to pay."
I think he will,"
If you're not lying to him, Rin said after a moment of hesitation. Money counters are expensive.
Good. That will secure our food and shelter, and we can begin to make our plans from there.
Whoa there! What do you mean, our plans? Rin asked, scowling. Last time I checked, you were you and I was me. Don't get it confused. I saved you to get a reward, not because I fancied your face.
Hiding the amusement that caused a small smile to rise to his face, Garrett agreed with a nod.
That's true, and you'll get a reward. But before that, I'm still going to need help. Look, I can't even sit up in a chair without you. How am I supposed to work for Hendrik without your assistance? And as much as I hate to admit it, I'll also need someone to help me with getting dressed, eating, and the like.
Recoiling, Rin fixed Garrett with a glare.
Listen to me and listen well, she hissed. I'm no maid, and I won't be bossed around by you.
Of course not.
What I am talking about is a partnership, Garrett said, giving her a calm smile. His face, though on the thin side and white as a sheet from his recent sickness, was easy to look at, and his gray eyes seemed to carry a strangely magnetic pull, making it hard for Rin to look away. Seeing her pause, he continued to speak, his voice slow and deliberate.
What I lack in physical ability, you can provide. I can provide the means of our survival, a simple exchange of services, if you will.
Spotting the hesitation in Rin's expression, Garrett deftly changed the subject.
But the first thing we need is an understanding of our situation. Tell me about Hendrik and this building.
Ah, this is the Dreamer's Inn, Rin said, glancing out the window. It used to be a manor a long time ago, but since the river began to flood this district, it's become a stop-off point for the adventurers heading toward the swamp. As for Hendrik, he runs the inn. He's also the leader of the Ghoul's Tooth Gang.
Closing his eyes, Garrett listened as Rin continued to speak, doing his best to match up the little bits he knew with what she was explaining. It was obvious that before he'd been wounded, he'd never entered this area of the city, but he was familiar enough with the rumors of it. The city of Insomnium was ruled by a king and protected by an order of powerful, awakened warriors who served him, but the true power structure of the city was much more complicated than that. Even when he'd been the former prince's advisor, Garrett had heard of the gangs that controlled the slums, and the adventurers who ventured out of the city's large walls, bringing back spoils and material from their monster hunts. This world was filled with monsters, and many of them could be dissected into valuable components with many uses. Hearing that Hendrik wasn't only running a gang, but was also managing an inn for adventurers, it was easy for Garrett to understand just how influential he was in this part of the city.
He owed my older brother, Rin said. But he's a cheap skinflint and took every coin I had for the use of that little storeroom he threw us in. And I mean every single one. If you're thinking about trying to trick him, don't. Hendrik will kill you and then sell your bones for a few coppers.
Got it. Is he an awakened?
I don't know. Rin shook her head. But those two muscle heads he has with him are.
It wasn't long before heavy footsteps in the hallway announced Henrik's return, and he opened the door with a greasy smile, clearly happy.
"A room and 2 meals a day," he said, staring at Garrett with a greedy gaze. "You'll handle my books and write letters for me."
3 meals and furniture for the room we're staying in. 2 beds with sheets, a table, a chair, and candles," Garrett replied calmly, "and a silver a month."
The smile on Henrik's face morphed into a sneer, and he walked forward, leaning on the desk to glare at Garrett.
"Are you trying to bargain with me? How about I cripple your left arm and throw you into the alley for the scavengers to pick apart?"
Ignoring the stink of Henrik's breath, Garrett calmly reached out and tapped the account book.
"In return, I'll show you why you're missing 15 gold and tell you who took it."
About to reach across the desk to throttle him, Hendrik froze at Garrett's words. The room was silent as the two men stared at each other, Henrik's bloodshot eyes meeting Garrett's cold gaze. Despite the pathetic condition of the young man in front of him, Hendrik found that the blazing anger in his mind was quickly draining away, replaced by a thick thread of caution. He knew next to nothing about the one-armed cripple sitting at his desk, but years of judging people had left him with a good sense for those who should be treated carefully, and currently his instincts were screaming at him that the young man he was staring at was one such person. Licking his lips, Henrik suddenly smiled and nodded his head.
Great. It's a deal, then.
Chapter 4. It was astounding how much of a difference a full meal could make. For Rin, who had been surviving on rough bread and water for weeks, the two large bowls of stew with actual meat looked like a feast, and she didn't wait for Garrett to start before digging in. Though he was just as hungry as she was, Garrett didn't begin eating right away. Directing the large men who were carrying furniture into the small room where to put the second bed, he made sure everything was in place before starting on his stew. He wasn't sure what sort of meat he was eating, and he suspected he was better off not knowing. Henrik had moved quickly after agreeing to Garrett's terms, and the room he and Rin would be sharing was cleaned out and filled with furniture, lending some dignity to the shabby space. Sensing that Rin was looking at him, Garrett paused, his spoon hovering in the air as he looked up. She had practically inhaled her food and was staring at his bowl with undisguised desire. Finishing his bite, he fished out a chunk of meat for himself and then passed the bowl over to her.
"What? Aren't you hungry?"
she asked, grabbing the bowl and pulling it toward her. Shaking his head, Garrett started to chew on his thick slice of brown bread.
"No. And besides, you'll need the energy more than me, since you'll be doing more physical work."
"Ah, that's true," Rin said, rapidly ladling hot stew into her mouth without even blowing on it. They had come to an agreement to work together after Garrett had managed to convince Henrik to give him a chance, and Rin was to be responsible for helping Garrett with things he needed as well as running errands. She had turned out to be the same age as Garrett, 17 years old, and had spent her whole life on the streets, giving her a wealth of helpful knowledge about the area. After the meal, Garrett sent Rin back to the kitchen with the bowls and leaned back against the wall. Even with the little bit he'd eaten, he could feel some strength returning to his body. The table had been pulled up against the side of his bed, so it was easy for him to reach, and the account book sat on it. He had told Henrik he would need at least one night to go over it, as well as a new, clean account book to copy everything over. Promising to have one of his men deliver the new account book, Henrik had given the command to have the furniture brought to the room, and then disappeared to do who knew what. The light from the small window was fading fast, but Rin had secured a candle from somewhere, keeping the room well lit. Feeling like he had some space for the first time since he'd first woken up, Garrett closed his eyes and began to examine his condition. He had discovered a few startling things since waking up, and now that he had a chance to reference them against his memories, he was beginning to understand what was going on. He had no idea how he was doing it, but as he closed his eyes and concentrated his mind, he found himself able to sense his body's condition. According to his memories, this was called inner sight, and was something that only an awakened could do. The strange spark of energy that appeared in the center of his chest was the second indication he had awakened, which provided a clear explanation for why Garrett was still alive. Casting his mind back to the classes he'd taken as the prince's study aide, he reviewed what he knew about awakening. While not all soul sparks granted supernatural strength and speed, they all gave their bearer exceptional endurance, allowing them to survive wounds that would have killed even the strongest unawakened warrior. That explained how Garrett was still breathing, despite having his hand removed, his legs crippled, and being thrown into the river. According to what he'd learned, soul sparks were divided into three main categories. Weapon sparks were soul sparks that would form weapons, typically granting their bearer supernatural abilities with that type of weapon. For instance, someone with a weapon spark in the shape of a bow might have uncanny accuracy no matter the distance they shot from, or the ability to control their arrows mid-flight. Monster sparks, which were rarer than weapon sparks, took the shape of a monster and granted their bearer increased speed and strength as well as a feature of that monster. This could be anything from spectral claws to the ability to stick to vertical surfaces or even powerful senses. The final type of soul spark was the rarest, and was referred to as a tool spark, as they took the shape of specific tools. Tool sparks carried varied powers that were practically impossible to quantify, making them highly sought after. Though he could see the soul spark that rested quietly in his chest, Garrett had no idea what sort of spark he carried, as it was still in the earliest stage, the lighting stage, and hadn't yet been shaped. Awakening was, as far as Garrett knew, a random thing, with most people awakening at some point between the age of 15 and 25. At 17, Garrett was on the younger side, but the fact that he had a soul spark at all was shocking to him. Following the lighting stage, in which the awakened grew their soul spark from a tiny firefly into a roaring star, was the shaping stage, in which the awakened would focus on the emerging shape of their soul spark, condensing and polishing their soul spark until it was lifelike. The final stage, and one that Garrett had never encountered, even in his time in the palace, was that of manifesting, when the soul spark could be projected from the awakened's body and used in the real world. According to the stories, the strength a manifesting stage awakened could wield was legendary, enough to split seas and crush mountains. But as far as Garrett knew, all of that was simply hearsay. Regardless, he was happy to discover that he was awakened, even if he was only at the beginning of the lighting stage. With his eyes closed, he pushed his mind closer to the spark in his chest and suddenly felt a whooshing sound as his vision changed. Blinking in surprise, he found himself in the small room with the ornate chair. Once again, his body was whole and a small window was floating in front of him. "Welcome to the dream. Your current objective is to gain your first level. EXP 3 of 10. Instead of standing up and leaving the room like he had the last time, Garrett took a moment to carefully examine the room. Unlike what he thought the first time he'd appeared here, the room in the dream wasn't an exact copy of his room in the real world. The furniture had appeared in the room, but the small window that let light into the room in the real world didn't exist. Instead, the light that filled the room came from the throne he was sitting in. Furthermore, the room in the dream was considerably bigger than the room in the real world. Unsure what caused the differences, Garrett could only shrug. Curious about what had caused him to leave the dream the first time he'd visited it, Garrett tried to focus on the spark glowing in his chest, only to find himself back in the real world, the spark in his chest, noticeably dimmer. Feeling like he'd latched onto something, Garrett returned to the dream, this time standing up as soon as he'd arrived and walking for the door. Dismissing the now familiar notification informing him he was leaving the safe zone, Garrett stepped out into the hallway. The ever-present haze was clearer than it had been the first time, and as he walked forward, it continued to vanish. At the same time, Garrett could see the soul spark that illuminated his surroundings was starting to fade in strength. Though he wasn't exactly sure what was happening, he continued to pace back and forth in the long hall, watching as the hallway grew clearer and clearer, and his soul spark continued to dim. Finally, with a shudder, his soul spark grew dark, and he fell out of the dream, falling unconscious on his bed. When he woke up, he'd fallen to the side and nearly slid off the bed. Gripping the side of the table with his left hand, he used his right arm to push his torso up. He had no idea how much time had passed, but from the pounding in his head and the weak light coming from his soul spark, he knew he'd done something foolish. Letting out a groan, he reached for the mug of water that had been left on the table from lunch and sipped at it. Since his head was still pounding, he rolled over on his bed and closed his eyes, preparing to go to sleep, only to hear footsteps approaching the room. A moment later, the door opened and Rin came bounding in, a thick, leather-bound book in her hand.
"Here's your new account book. Oh, and more ink and a new quill, too. Are you really going to go through that whole book and find gold? How does that even work?"
Lifting himself up, Garrett pulled himself to the table and took the items Rin offered. The account book was completely blank, though when he looked closely, Garrett could tell that a few pages had been cut out of the front of it. The quill, on the other hand, had never been used, and the ink was in sealed vials. Running his hand over the smooth cover, Garrett smiled. Chances are good that the gold is missing. If Henrik is as much of a penny pincher as you've said, he probably knows that the gold is gone for good. But knowing where it went is a different matter. Every entry in this book has been initialed, which means that so long as we know where the errors have occurred, we should be able to track down where the money has gone. At the very least, it will give us a place to start. And by us, I mean Henrik and his men. We'll do the basic groundwork, and they can do the actual investigation to get the money back.
Wouldn't it be better if we got the money back?
Rin asked, her eyes gleaming as she imagined what a stack of gold would look like.
No, absolutely not.
You're no match for the men who took it, and neither am I. I mean, I can barely move. What will we do if the money is in the pocket of someone like Obe? Better to let Henrik handle it. Besides, it's highly likely all the money is gone already. This book goes back almost 4 years.
Ah, that's true, Rin said with a disappointed pout.
Pulling the chair over, she sat down and watched dejectedly as Garrett opened the two account books up. Sitting in a strange inn in a strange world without his right hand or the use of his legs, Garrett felt like he should be going crazy right now. But strangely, his mind seemed to have completely adapted to his new situation. A wry smile crossed his lips as he stared at the two books. If he could identify any similarity between his old life on Earth and his new life in this world, it was staring at him in the form of the juxtaposition between the messy account book and the clean, new account book. This wasn't the first time he'd kept books for those who skirted the edge of the law, and as he immersed himself in the tangled numbers, he could feel himself relaxing.
At least numbers don't change, and people don't either.
Time crept on, and Rin watched Garrett carefully. With only one hand, he moved slowly and wrote in shaky lines, but little by little the first page of the old ledger was copied into the new one. Though his new ledger didn't have lines in it, Garrett made sure to take his time and lay it out in nice columns so lines could be added later. The pages of the old account book were packed with scribbles, creating a confusing mess of numbers, but Garrett didn't get flustered as he moved through them. Occasionally, he would use a scrap of paper to record a bunch of numbers and do some calculations before writing them down in the new book. Noticing that Garrett was writing more numbers in the new book, Rin leaned over to try to understand what he was doing. Seeing her interest, Garrett paused to explain.
This is called double-entry bookkeeping. It's a method to ensure money doesn't go missing.
Oh, that's how you're going to find the missing coins?
Correct. Using this method, we'll be able to determine what money has come in and what money has gone out. Furthermore, we track the overall flow of money over time. It's useful for our financial forensics, as well as setting up the data we need to find areas of improvement.
Looking at Garrett suspiciously, Rin glanced down at the neat columns Garrett had created, and then back up at him.
You just said a lot of words, but I didn't understand any of them.
That's fine, Garrett said, waving his hand. It just means we're laying the groundwork for our second plan.
What second plan?
The plan where we make ourselves indispensable to Henrik, Garrett replied, picking up his quill and dipping it in the open vial of ink. But to get there, we have to do this first step properly. Would you mind fetching dinner? It should be about time.
Nodding, Rin got up. But her eyes kept drifting back to the neat-looking book Garrett was writing in, interest clear in her eyes.
Is this something you'd like to learn how to do? Garrett asked, putting his quill down and looking at her.
Meeting Garrett's gaze, Rin was shocked out of her daze by the cold, calculating look in his eyes. The difference between the look in his eyes and the words that came out of his mouth often shook her, causing her to wonder about the person she'd rescued. He was weak as a sick cat, but held the eyes of a predator, making her wonder what he'd gone through to end up in such a disastrous situation.
No, I couldn't, Rin said, shaking her head. I don't know how to read or write.
Do you know how to add and subtract?
If I counted on my fingers, Rin said, blushing slightly.
Then I can teach you, Garrett said, picking up his quill again.
For now, get dinner, and then we'll discuss it.
Chapter 5. Late that night, Garrett listened to Rin's soft breathing, his mind running through the day. It had always been his habit to spend a few moments at the end of his day examining the choices he'd made, and as he reviewed his day, he was once again struck by the absurdity of his situation. It was fruitless to dwell on the strangeness of his situation, however, and he soon turned his attention to a more profitable question. The soul spark he carried was shining once again, almost as brightly as it had been when he'd first noticed it.
When I move around in the safe zone, there's no change to my soul spark, but it clearly depletes as I move outside of the safe zone. There must be something in that haze that's depleting it. If I think of it as a battery, then it's clear that moving around outside my room takes power, while being still recharges it.
Letting his mind sink into the soul spark, Garrett entered the dream, appearing in the glowing chair once again. The first thing he did was check the room he was in. The table was exactly as he had left it, with the two account books sitting side by side and the inkpot he was using in between them. He had left the quill he'd been given lying across the two books, its edge precisely aligned with the square bottom of the inkpot. Seeing it, an idea struck him. Reaching out, he picked it up, watching as it turned from the dull gray that enveloped everything in the room into its familiar pale brown color. Running his finger along the soft edge of the feather, he examined it, marveling at how real it felt. As soon as he touched it, he felt his soul spark starting to dim, but the glow from the throne seemed to sink into him, replacing the energy his soul spark was losing. Carefully placing the quill down next to the new account book, he turned his attention to Rin, who was sleeping in the bed across the room. He could faintly see her lying in the bed, covered by the sheets, but she was dim and dark, looking more like a wax doll than a real person. Curious, he walked over and tried to touch her, but before he could, his hand encountered a firm obstruction and a window popped up in front of his face. You have not yet unlocked the ability to enter other people's dreams. Advance to level 1 to unlock this ability. EXP 3 of 10. Frowning, Garrett closed his eyes and thought for a moment. Remembering he had another skill he hadn't used yet, he activated Whisper of the Dream, his ability that was supposed to let him communicate with other people mentally. Yet, just like before, nothing happened, apart from another window popping up. This ability can currently only be used with those who are awakened. Improve your skill level with this ability to pass messages to mortals.
This again. Does this mean I could have sent a message to Gorn or Obey, but not Rin? And why is it using the term mortal? How do I increase my level? Wait, if there are personal levels and skill levels, do I have something like a character sheet? How would I access something like that?
Letting his hand fall back to his side, Garrett tried to figure out how to get the system to respond, but no matter what he did, it remained entirely silent. He'd only heard the mechanical voice that announced the system once, so it was possible there wasn't a way to interact with it directly apart from the windows that popped up on occasion. After wasting nearly 25 minutes on it, he finally put the issue aside for the moment and moved to the door to go out into the hall. He had been out of the door twice now, but had never tried to come back in, instead finding himself forcefully ejected when his soul spark ran out of power. For his entire life on Earth, he had moved cautiously. But now Garrett found that the memories of living for 17 years in this fantastical world and the emotions of being 17 had mixed together, causing him to have a strong desire to explore everything he could. Thankfully, the countless years of obsessive checking and double-checking he'd done throughout his life on Earth had built enough muscle memory that he didn't just rush out to explore. Stepping out of the safe zone, he turned around and tried the door, feeling quite relieved when it opened up for him. While testing entering and exiting a few times, he paid close attention to the amount of glow his soul spark lost each time, soon realizing it was only reduced when he moved through spaces he hadn't seen before. The more he walked in the passage, the clearer it became, transforming from a hazy, dreamlike state into a completely solid hallway. Emboldened by this realization, Garrett opened the door to the office next to his room and walked in.
Just like before, he could see the layout of the room, though the items on the desk had changed. Even before he walked in, he could see the path he had walked previously marked out by a lack of haze. Everywhere he'd already stepped, the dream appeared more real, especially around the desk. There was no one in the office at this time of night, so he was able to explore it freely. But he still focused his attention on the desk, both because it would require less energy, since he had been there before, and because that's where the important documents seemed to be. When he'd been carried into the office earlier in the day, he had looked around to try and figure out where the most valuable items were and had spotted a number of papers stacked to one side of the desk. Garrett had no qualms about the position he was in. Even with his awakening and the strange new world he found himself able to enter, there was absolutely no way he could compete with Henrik or either of the goons who followed him around. It wasn't simply a lack of confidence, either. While his young, noble self had studied swordsmanship with the prince growing up, he'd never even drawn the blood of an animal, let alone the blood of a human. On top of that, all his fights had been with guards who held a vested interest in letting him win. While his earthling memories were filled with bloodshed, close-range physical violence wasn't something he was proficient in. At first, Garrett had considered trying to meld the two sets of memories together to try and come up with some sort of fighting proficiency, but he soon gave that up when he realized just how strong Obey and Gorn were and how powerless he was. Maybe he would have had a chance to protect himself if he'd chosen the path of the blade, but since he'd already chosen the path of the Watcher, he was going to focus on his strengths. He was hoping the papers would give him information he could use to keep himself and Rin safe. He had no idea if the papers were worth the effort, but he still reached out for them, feeling energy drain out of him as his fingers closed around them. Pulling items from the real world into the dream world took considerable energy, and actually picking up the papers left him nearly empty, so he quickly put them back down and returned to his room. He was feeling a headache starting to form as he reached the door to his room, but as soon as he opened the door and felt the light emanating from the glowing throne, the pain eased, and he found himself able to breathe easy again. It took nearly half an hour for him to recharge his soul spark, but once he had, he returned to the office intending to examine the papers he'd accessed earlier. To his surprise, the glow on the papers had faded slightly, and a grayish tint had covered them. Realizing the haze of the dream was starting to seep back into them, he picked up the stack of papers, sighing as about a quarter of his energy faded. Leafing through the papers, he found the corners of his lips slowly rising in a smile. The papers detailed many things, but the one he found most interesting was a list of contacts with notes listed by them, identifying what sorts of goods they would buy and their levels of trustworthiness. In his past life, Garrett had hung out with enough thieves to recognize he was looking at a fence's contact book, and he took a moment to study it. While he currently had no goods to move, it was always a good idea to know who was dealing on the dark side, just in case there was a chance to use them later. Besides, according to his memories from his time in the palace, there were plenty of ways to get goods in this world, especially with a gang's help. The rest of the papers were receipts and order forms from the docks listing a number of goods being moved from one warehouse to another. Without more information, there was nothing Garrett could do with the forms, and other than the list of contacts, there was nothing much of interest in the pile, so he put the papers back on the desk. He had just placed it down on the table when a chill raced up his spine, and he spun around to face the window, yelping in shock as he saw the strange robed figure with the giant crimson eye in the middle of its face staring at him. The chill that took hold of him grew deeper, causing his legs to shake as the monster pressed itself against the glass. He had only caught a glimpse of the monster from the side before, and now that he was staring directly at it, he couldn't help but shudder. Looking like a hunched old man with wrinkled skin, the monster's vertical eye that covered its entire face glared at Garrett, a strange power making it impossible for him to look away. Desperate to blink and tear his eyes away from the terrifying sight, Garrett could feel the energy in his soul spark being drained away as he resisted the monster's gaze. This infuriated the monster, which suddenly screeched, causing its large eye to begin splitting down the middle, almost as if another eye was opening up in the middle of its pupil. A trickle of blood ran down the window as its eye was ripped apart, an even stronger crimson eye appearing inside of it. Dreadful whispers started to swirl around Garrett, and with supreme effort he tore himself away, falling to the ground as he bumped into the desk. Papers scattered across the floor in his haste, but he didn't care one bit. Scrambling along the floor, he thought about hiding behind the desk, but as he caught sight of his hand on the wooden floor, terror raced through him. On the back of his hand, he could see a strange bulging, as if something was pressing against his skin from the inside. A thin red line appeared in the center of the bulge, and his skin started to rip apart, revealing a crimson eyeball underneath. Fear like he'd never felt raced through him, and he lunged for the door. Pulling the door shut behind him, he crawled for the door to his room, doing his best not to look at bulges that were beginning to form on his arms. Pain coursed through his arms as the eyes that were beginning to open up stared wildly around, each trying to catch his gaze. With each crimson eye that appeared, he could sense himself losing control of his body, and soon a terrible pain struck his face, causing it to feel like it was about to split open. Blood dripped down from his chin as he got his hand on the doorknob to his room, splashing against the aged wooden floorboards. Feeling the strength slipping from his fingers, he twisted the knob and pushed the door open, falling into the small opening. His body was still behind the door, but as he flopped forward, his face fell into the room and the warm light of the throne washed over him. A faint sizzle covered him as the bulging in his face subsided, burnt away by the light. Yet even as the eye vanished from his face, the eyes on his arms blinked, glowing with crimson light. Completely outside his control, his hands gripped the floor of the hallway and tried to pull his body backward, away from the light of the throne. With a desperation that bordered on insanity, he opened his mouth and bit down on the edge of the door, preventing himself from being pulled back out into the hallway. A vicious tug of war began as his possessed limbs tried to pry him loose, and he tried to pull himself forward with just his teeth. Thanks to the light seeping into his head, his soul spark, that was nearly completely inert.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.